what we're doing. Oh, yes, Kim slipped that one up already. Do you recognize her?
Yes, yes. That would be me, Carolyn.
Yesterday, a week ago, a couple of years ago. And I'd be me in, it's October of 1971.
Yeah.
You see, when Drew came a few months ago and he said to me, Anne, I really want to do Galatians. I think we should do a study on Galatians and on freedom, that we're free people. I right away said, that is awesome. Love Galatians. That's me coming home from my long extended couple years road trip that I did when I was young. And during the end of that, I ended up at a place called La Brie. I've told you that story a little bit. And my faith came alive at that point. And when I was leaving La Brie, what the fellow in charge, Ronald, did, he said, as he made plans for me as I was leaving, he said, you got to do a Bible study, Anne, and I want you to study Deuteronomy and Galatians. You know Deuteronomy? Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy, right? It's one of those ones in the Old Testament at the beginning. He said, I want you to read Deuteronomy, and he gave me bits of it to read because it's the second giving of the law. I want you to know the law, Anne. But then I want you to read Galatians because I want you to know clearly you're free from the law. That's not you. You are a new creation in Christ, and I want you to learn to listen to the Spirit of Christ within you, to let your life be led by the Spirit of Christ, to let that Spirit of God come alive within you. So I cut my teeth. My first Bible study I ever did was Deuteronomy and Galatians. So I was absolutely delighted when Drew said that he would do Galatians here with us. He's been doing it since May 29th, so what I get to do all during June and July and August, been doing Galatians and freedom, I get to wrap it all up this week. And I get to bring that puppy home. We're going to lay it to rest, right? I get to finish it up. So what I want to do for you is a bit of a summary of Galatians. My old Bible teacher in me says, I want to make sure you have a sense of what the book of Galatians is all about. So I want to do a little bit of Galatians with you. But I want to look back on where we've gone on our trip. Because, you know, when you come home from any holiday, it's important to come home well. And you don't just come in and rush right back into life. You need to come back in and look at your trip. Think about your trip a little bit. Look at the souvenirs. Consider the memories a little bit. So I want to do a little bit of that with us too. So we'll do a summary of Galatians, and we'll do a little review of where we've been on our trip. And then I got a little something else, my own little bit that I'll add in for you. So we're going to do on a road trip to freedom. That's what we're up to. So, yes, on this road trip. The first thing I said I wanted to do, I wanted to just touch base a little bit on Galatians. So we had a little bit of a history review of that sort of thing. And you know the book is in the New Testament, and it's a letter from Paul. And it's a letter from Paul to the churches that are up there. See the big word Asia, below there is Galatia. That blue line is a map, I think, of his second journey. Paul made three journeys that we know of for sure. And even on his first trip, he went up into Galatia, to Derbe, to Lystra, and Antioch. He visited those places. He visited them on each of his other trips, too. And this letter from the Galatians was written by Paul, and it's ever so cool because in it, it says right at the end when he finishes it off, he says he's writing it in his big, see with what large letters I make when I'm writing in my own hand. You know, he may have scribed most of the letter, I don't know, but part of it he wrote with his own hand to these people up in Galatia. It's really special. He wrote it about 50 AD. We're not sure whether he wrote it after his first journey or his second journey, but it was around 50 AD that he wrote it. He wrote to them. And it's very clear on the reason why he wrote the letter. They had come to faith, they were alive and vibrant in their faith, and then some other people came in and told them they had to obey the law. So when we look at Galatians, kind of the purpose of Galatians is that it was written to counter the false teachers who believe that a person has to keep the Jewish law in order to be right with God. These people had come to faith, and then these other Jewish teachers came in and said, no, rules, rituals, especially circumcision, had to happen for the men. So it was written to counter them. And the basic truth that's embedded in here is that through our faith in Christ Jesus, by God's grace, we're a new creation. Now we are to live in the fullness of the freedom in our new life in Christ. So that's why I was given it, so that I would know the freedom, that I would know my new life in Christ, and that that's what I would live out of. And if I was to give you a summary of what Galatians looked like, the first two chapters, Paul is defending the gospel of grace, defending his own ministry, and then he's explaining the gospel of grace, how it works, grace and law work, and then he applies the gospel of grace in the last two chapters, so that is encouragement that we'll live a life in the Spirit. So technically, that's what Galatians is all about. But when I look at that, like that's what you'll get. Any Bible book will teach you that sort of that purpose and that basic truth and that scripture outline. That's all basic to understanding what Galatians is about. But I tell you, when I look at when I've made that all out, I got to give them that. It's just so dry. To me, that doesn't touch in on the wonder, the spectacle, the greatness of Galatians at all. Galatians is a hugely passionate letter. Paul is a man, and it comes through so much in Galatians. He's gone in there, all these people in Galatia who come to faith are Gentiles. They've come out of one way of life into a whole new way of life. He's come, he's met them, he's ate with them, he stayed with them, he knows them. He loves them deeply and dearly. They are his children. They're his dear and precious children. They've heard the stories of Jesus. And when they heard the stories of Jesus about his life, his death, and his resurrection, something marvelous happened inside them, and their lives were changed. They knew the transformative power of Jesus in their lives, turning everything upside down, and they were vibrant. They were humming. They were happy and joyful and free. They were delightful children for Paul, and he loved them dearly. Can you imagine any child you know and to see the innocence of a child taken away? Oh gosh, no. He's so angry. Can you remember any times of a first love? And when that gets dashed away, these people were in love with Jesus and they've been robbed of their first love. And Paul is so annoyed. He is so angry. He is so hurt. He is so grieving that these people were robbed of their first love of Jesus. They've lost it. They've lost the innocence. They've lost the vibrancy. How dare someone come and say that to them? Oh, it is a passionate letter. There's passion that flows through it. So yes, this is what a Bible study will take you, but you always have to read underneath these teachings so that you get the reason why we read Galatians. He has to defend himself. The false teachers come in and they say to the Galatians, forget about Paul, he's nobody, he's nothing, he's a troublemaker, he's wrong. Listen to us. And so in the first couple of chapters, Paul has to say again, this is who I am. I am called by God. And I received this truth by revelation. I got it straight from the hand of God. And it got confirmed everywhere. That it is by the life, the death, and the resurrection of Jesus. That's what it's all about. That's what it's all about. If it was by something that you did, then he's saying, I'd be a winner. I kept the law. I kept the law. But it's not. It's about Jesus and his power to change us. So he begins with defending what that is. And then he explains the gospel of grace to them. He puts the perspective on the law. That the false teachers have come in and they've said, the law is king. The rule book rules. Follow the rules. You men, be circumcised. I can't believe the men did it. I know, that boggles my mind. But anyway, you got to follow the rules. You got to be circumcised. That's what you have to do. The law is king. And Paul said, no. Jesus is king. It's about Jesus. Who is Jesus? How did he live? His death, his resurrection. It's about Jesus, is what it's about. And so he does a little history thing for them. First, there was the promise to Abraham that Abraham would be blessed beyond all the nations. Through faith, through grace, gift God, all of that. Then came the law. Then came Jesus that fulfilled the law. And it all is about Jesus. All there. And his last couple of chapters are on how we are to live. That we are to live a life of grace, a life of loving each other, a life led by the Spirit. Galatians 5:1, it is for freedom that Christ has set us free. Stand firm and don't let yourselves be burdened. And he gives a lot of descriptions there of old life, of new life, of flesh life, of spirit life. He uses prison imagery and freedom imagery in there. That we are to live a life, the Spirit of Christ is within us. We are to breathe that Spirit, and we are to live that Spirit of Christ into the world, moment by moment, day by day, to everyone, to ourselves, to our family, to our friends, to our workplace, to our community. We are to live, to do good to one another, especially the family of faith, he says. So that's my kind of synopsis of Galatians. And we've been there, as I say, since the end of May 29th. We've been picking verses and doing some teaching around Galatians. My suggestion to you there, having done my 7-minute review of everything you need to know about Galatians, in there, is read it. It's not a long book. If you haven't done that already during these months, do read it. In a variety of translations, use the Message, use NIV, use something modern and easy, and read it. It won't take you long. As I say, it's only 6 chapters. It's not long. And when you read it, remember the passion of Paul, that it's a passionate letter. It's not a theological, what's that word, treaty or something, treatise? That's not what it was written about. We've made it into theology. That's been our work that we have done. Paul was in love with those people, and he was writing to people he knew and he loved, and he wanted to have them free in Christ. He wanted to give them back their first love. So when you read it, remember you're reading Paul and the people he loved. So Galatians on our road trip to freedom. Galatians is our first kind of key site that we visited. But then I wanted to go over some of the other places that we kind of stopped at, some other sites that we saw as we made our journey through it. Some of the things we talked about were the central faith that's very clear that Paul is reminding them of, that's core. It's all about Jesus, his life, his death, and his resurrection. That's what our faith is to be about too. One of the other things we saw on our journey was that it's bigger than we are. It came as revelation. The whole concept of the death and the resurrection of Jesus isn't something you logically sit down and think through and think out. Yes, you can apply your mind, but there's another whole piece that is revelation, that is the openness of your heart and your mind to the words of God to come into you. That it's bigger than we are. And what happens when we receive it is a transformative piece. And so we spent a little bit of time talking about the transformative piece that goes on too. And that what happens when the Spirit comes to live in us. We did a lot of things on what happens, what are some of the fruit of what happens to us when we're living full, when we're in love with Jesus. And one of them is the freedom to live in unity with all sorts of people. People we wouldn't normally chum with are part of our family because of faith. In Galatians, they talk about Jew and Gentile, slave and master, male and female, everybody all together. And that extends for us today, that we are to live in unity, even with people with whom we have differences, because love conquers all. Freedom from conformity, we spent a little bit of time on that, that our conformity is to the image of Christ within us, not to people's expectations on us. And freedom from constraints. We are free to follow the love of God, not bound by rules and rituals and regulations. And we become free to serve others. serve in multiple ways. We spent on different ways to serve, that our focus is not around ourself, but it is around others, from a healthy perspective though, and seeing how we can extend the kingdom of God with justice and with peace. Freedom to care for others, that's the last one of the ones that we touched in on, that we are to have a love in our hearts for one another, for our love will always be shown in community life first. So those were some of them. When I looked back over the different sermons that we've done and things, I sort of pulled out sort of some themes, and those are some of the ones that I found. But the wonderful thing is when you take a trip with other people, they'll see different things. So many of you have been here faithfully week after week. Some of you have come in the odd weeks as you can, but you will have heard different things than I heard as we made our road trip to freedom. So I would love that. Maybe that's one thing we can be doing in the forum time, is thinking a little bit about what have you heard in the last couple of months? Has there been a particular word, a particular message that's been helpful to you or unhelpful to you, that's troubled you or has energy for you? That might be one of the things for us to do in the forum, I thought, today. Because it's important that when you complete a trip, that you don't just rush back into life, but you take some time to digest that trip. Where have I been? What have I seen? What have I experienced? And to begin to name it. I'll give you just a moment now, just to pause with that one. I remember in the early 60s, my parents went to Italy. And you know, it's not like today. Today we go everywhere all the time, right? But back in the 60s, it was a big deal to have them go to Italy for 2 or 3 weeks, a month, whatever it was. It was a big deal. And it was very, when they came home, they'd really been affected by their trip. They didn't know what Italian food was. Can you imagine that? You know, they didn't know what Italian food was because we didn't, outside of pizza, we didn't have Italian restaurants everywhere in Toronto. So they came back all full of the wonder of Italian food, the beauty of Italian art, and we began to have minestrone soup on our table with freshly grated Parmesan cheese on it. You know, we'd never had that before. I know it sounds peculiar now, but it was a change. They'd been on a trip, they'd experienced something, they came home, and things changed. They were different because of it. So too, on our road trip to freedom, I want to make sure that you have a chance to harvest what you may have learned on this trip. Maybe you come away from it and you realize you want to know more about Scripture. You really didn't know anything about this thing called Galatians that was in this book called the Bible. You didn't really know anything about it. And something inside you says, I'd like to learn more Scripture. I'd like to know more of that. Maybe that's one of your takeaways. We've got compass groups. Come and join us. We'll have 4 of them in the fall that do Scripture study. Maybe you come away from this and you realize, you know what? I don't really know that much about the life, the death, and the resurrection of Jesus. I haven't quite nailed that one down. And I think I need to know that, because somehow that seems critically, greatly important. If that perks inside you, seeking Allah, finding Jesus. I think the men's group is going to do it. A lot of other people are reading to it. Yes, it teaches you about Islam, but the guy's journey is one of rubbing against Christians who talked to him about the fundamental core beliefs of who Jesus is, about Jesus' death, about his resurrection, about the Trinity, and he asks questions, and it's a wonderful kind of primer that's got tiny short chapters, that if that perks inside you, that might be a place to go. Or maybe you come out of the trip and you're wondering about this new creation stuff. Like, how am I a new creation? What does it mean to have God's Spirit within me? Well, you can imagine what I'm going to show you on that one. I got all my
good and beautiful stuff here, right, for that one. We got God, we got life, and we got community, and they are wonderful tools to help grow in a sense of who we are as Christians, to come alive. I'm going to do a new good and beautiful God. You got to start with God. You have to start with the good and beautiful God, because it sort of cleans up our thoughts about who God is and presses them into Jesus' story. And I'm going to start a new good and beautiful God on a Wednesday evening, if you'd like to join me on that one. And we might do a daytime one, if I can find another leader. So we might do a daytime one too, but let me know about that. It might be that. So it might be scripture, it might be core beliefs, you know, it might be new creation stuff. But I wonder too, that some of you might be feeling like those Galatians were feeling. I wonder if you might come away from it feeling like you've been robbed of your first love, too. And you want it back. Or you realize, maybe, that you've never actually fallen in love with Jesus. I don't want this to be just another trip for you. I want it to be a significant one. I want you to harvest what you're to harvest from this trip. As I prepared this, and I sat around with kind of Galatians all around me and all the things that we'd done all around me, I was aware that, you know, certainly as a young woman, I was very drawn to freedom. I was drawn to finding out who I was and wanting to live that life fully. And I did the Bible study that Ronald gave me. I cut my teeth on Deuteronomy and Galatians, and I began to learn. Oh, I only began to learn. Like, it was the tip of the iceberg for me back in the early 70s. I began to learn of who I was and the freedom I have and that Christ lives in me, and that I live within the big love of God. I began to learn that, and I'm still learning that. You know, 45 years later, I'm still learning that. As I sat there with all of that Galatians stuff around me, I became aware that, you know, clearly we don't have the same issue that the Galatians had. You know, we don't have Jewish laws and circumcision and that sort of stuff happening. But we still have the same problem that they had. The story of church history is the story of people falling in love with Jesus and of telling the story to somebody else and they fall in love with Jesus. And telling the story to someone else and they fall in love with Jesus. That's how the church has spread from generation to generation to generation. And church history is the same story of false teachers coming in and taking away that first love, of giving us rules, of ways of behaving becoming so important. Time and time again, the life-changing experience has been pressed down by people. So today, where are we? We live in a post-Christian world. And so many people are what we would call cultural Christians rather than Christ-like Christians. We went to church as little kids because that's just the thing you do. And we never rubbed close to Jesus. We never heard him whisper into our lives, "I love you. I forgive you. You're mine. You're mine." We just did the cycle of things. That the life and the death and the resurrection of Jesus haven't shaped our souls. The life, the death, the resurrection of Jesus hasn't shaped our souls. We've been robbed of that first love experience. One of the verses that stood out for me so clearly was Galatians 1:6, when right at the beginning of the letter, Paul says to his dear friends there, "I am astonished that so quickly you are deserting the one who called you. you are turning away to another gospel. Oh, it is so easy for us to turn away from the gentle hand of God. God will never pressure, never push us, but will whisper, will invite always to come closer. One of the things that I really enjoy doing is helping people be in touch with Jesus, helping people be in touch with who he is, with those God moments in their life, that time when they could really sense his presence, and helping them put words to that, because it's helping people find their first love again. It's helping people to go back to the blush of the first experience, the first encounter with someone they loved. And one of the ways I love to do it is to ask some questions. So just to wrap up here, I did some finding our first love again so that we not be like the Galatians. One of the questions I ask is, when have you felt alive and expansive and connected? Have a moment when you have that awareness of being vitally real and present, connected to someone else. Those are God discovery moments. Second question there is, who is Jesus to you? Just talk to me about him. No rules, no regulations, no theology required, no Bible study required, no nothing that you learned in Sunday school required. Just, who is he to you? There's no right or wrong to it, but who is he to you? Just talk to me about him. Begin to put words to what he's like for you. Who's the Holy Spirit to you? Same thing. How did you receive the Spirit of Christ? Talk to me about your faith story, your history, your journey, your baptism, maybe your moment of encounter. How do you recognize the movement of the Spirit of Christ within your life, within us as a faith community, within the church, within the world? We are indwelt by the Spirit of God, and we are to live listening to the Spirit of God, not all that other crazy junk that goes around in your head all the time, not that stuff, no. We're to listen to the sweet whisper of the Spirit of God within you, the voice of goodness, the voice of trust, the voice of forgiveness, the voice of caring. Maybe, like the Galatians, you've been robbed of your first love. It's possible. Maybe there was a time your heart hummed for Jesus and you want it back. Or maybe you realize you've never had that experience and you'd like to have that. As we come to the end of our trip, I don't want it to be just another trip for you. I want you to have souvenirs from it, memories from it. I'd love it to change your life the way my parents got changed in Italy. The food you eat is different. The way you talk to people is different. The way you see people is different. The sparkle in your eye. I think as we wrap up here, we'll take just a moment of quiet and let you begin to think about Galatians and about where you've been and what you've heard and about who Jesus is for you. In what way has this trip been significant for you?